What is the oldest collection at the Canadian Museum of Nature? The National Collection traces its roots to the Geological Survey of Canada, and it was established in 1856. But did you know that the Canadian Museum of Nature holds and cares for a collection that is even older? Established in 1854, the Geological Survey of Canada Scientific Library is Canada's oldest scientific library. The original publications were supplied by Sir William Logan, but in 1854, the federal government voted to add £250 to the Geological Survey of Canada budget to ensure that a library containing the best standard of works of reference connected with geology and the allied sciences could be maintained. That is the equivalent of almost £22,000 sterling, or $36,000 today. Over time, the collections were split between the GSC and other national museums, but the Canadian Museum of Nature still holds elements of that original collection. That we call the Rare Book Collection. Made up of 5,000 monographs, this collection holds some of the oldest and most unique publications, and today we are going to take a look at a few. The oldest book. That's why we're here, right? I mean, it's not the oldest book ever printed, but it is the oldest book in the Canadian Museum of Nature library collection. L'Histoire entière des poissons was first published in Latin in 1554. The museum holds a copy of the 1558 edition, the first edition printed in a language other than Latin. French! Why is this book so interesting? Like the modern science work done at the museum, this book was the result of Guillaume Rondelet's observations of biodiversity that he saw or knew of. The book was used to transmit knowledge about the natural world, codifying it with a standard language. So standard was the language that many of the common fish names in the book are still in use today. Look at the bream and the boarfish. At the time of publication, there were 117 known fish species to the European science, but the book contains 440 entries and drawings. But how did Rondelet fill out the rest? Obviously, with other aquatic observations that were not necessarily fish. Here we have both mammals and reptiles. Speaking of observations that were not necessarily fishes, Rondelet also included a series of sea monsters. The sea monsters were treated the same way as other known species and were included in the biodiversity of the world. The late 1500s brought a lot of change to the European understanding as colonial empires, quote, discovered new land masses with biodiversity then unknown to Europeans. So who was to say that there weren't monsters lurking in those waterways? Were these then his best hypothesis, given his understanding of the world? Moving from the oldest publication, let's talk about the most unique. This unassuming volume is Entomologica Terra Nova by Philip Henry Gosse. This unpublished manuscript from 1833 is a book that proves the old adage, do not judge a book by its cover. This publication is the first systematic study of entomology on the island of Newfoundland. In 1827, at the young age of 17, Gosse set off to Newfoundland to work as a clerk for Slade, Elson, and Co., where he became an amateur student of entomology, and in 1832, he started to collect and record the entomological biodiversity of the island, work similar to any biodiversity survey of a region that we might see the Canadian Museum of Nature staff participate in today. Many of these observations were made using a microscope and are drawn to an accurate scale. However, this presents a challenge for the reader. Imagine, it was the 1830s and you have been invited to view this volume in Newfoundland, probably by whale oil light. As you squint and your eyes strain to get a better view of the image, Gosse had you covered. Many of these images were copied and enlarged to allow the reader to see the details better. While the two publications are about biodiversity, the technology used to create them is different. One is a hand-drawn and hand-colored. This method would not have been good for mass distribution, but the other used a printing technique called woodblock printing. With this style, the negative of the image, in this case, another monster, was carved into a wooden block to create a stamp of the image. This technique would have favored a wider distribution of the publication. Here we have another interesting title. Some of you may know of the ill-fated Franklin Expedition of 1845. In 2016, to much fanfare, the wreck of the HMS Terror was, quote, discovered in Terror Bay, Nunavut. But that was not the first Franklin expedition into the Arctic. In fact, that one was the third expedition that he led. This volume was published after the Coppermine Expedition. Looks pretty peaceful. I mean, that was the intent. Arctic work is not easy, nor is it cheap. This book was published so that the profits could be reinvested into future Arctic expeditions. The publication was an immediate success, documenting a part of the world that many Europeans would never see. But the book was more than just a tale of scientific observations. This one had starvation, skirmishes, exposure, death, and survival. At one point, the expedition ran so low on food that they ate lichens found on the land, like this rock tripe. At its heart, though, the first expedition was one to survey the Arctic region, make maps, and document geodiversity and biodiversity of the area. Are we sensing a familiar theme? This was a good thing for Franklin. He was an officer in the Royal Navy, and during that time, when there was no ongoing war where a naval officer could be promoted, surveying and biological inventory were considered a noble pursuit worthy of promotion. It is hard to talk about Arctic research and expedition without talking about the indigenous, Inuit, and Métis people that have lived and continue to live in the spaces which were new to Europeans. Unlike many publications of this period, this book identifies the indigenous participants through a European lens and discusses their roles in the expedition. I would like to take this moment to acknowledge that the museum is part of this legacy, and we continue to work with our indigenous and Inuit partners to find new approaches and better collaborations. Rare books don't always have to mean old. In fact, something that makes a book rare can be the limited nature of the release. With the Franklin book, it was so popular that the publisher could not keep up with demand, and a used book market grew up almost overnight. Romance of Nature, Art and Life of Christine Marshall, is an example of a limited series. The book is accompanied by a series of lithographic plates of illustrations that are featured in the publication. Lithographs are another example of print technologies that we have in the collection. A lithograph is made by drawing an image directly on a lithograph stone with a grease pencil, and then treating the stone so that the ink adheres to the drawing. Then a sheet is pressed into the inked up lithographic stone, creating a reverse of that image. A multicolored image like these require a stone for each color and multiple pressings. Lithography is both a technology and a technique that produces exquisite images. Like any collection, rare books need to be monitored for degradation. The Canadian Museum of Nature staff work hard to ensure that we preserve these precious documents for future generations. We have recently begun a conservation assessment of the over 5,000 publications in the collection with the support of students from the Université de Québec en Outaouais and Algonquin College. We plan to have this inventory completed in the spring of 2023. The biggest damage that we find with the collection is that the spines of the books are damaged and have come apart. This damage is telling. It shows that the books were opened, closed, taken off shelves, reshelved, and used in general. Once the conservation inventory is complete, we can plan and execute a conservation intervention from the least to most invasive treatment in partnership with conservation sciences programs. Here is an example of what can be done to the Franklin book in this case when all of the projects come together. These are just some of the rare books in the rare book collection. They are rare because they will never come again. When they are gone, the knowledge is lost. Canadian Museum of Nature is working with other partners to make some of the amazing content available through portals like the Biodiversity Heritage Library. We want to preserve these publications, but they also need to be used, and any of you can make an appointment and learn more about the collection or even volunteer to support its further digitization.